Well, there is this man who has been dubbed Bean Dad. Have you heard about him?
Bean Dad?
Yes. No. I've heard of Dub. Bean Dad, hashtag Bean Dad, was this like trending topic on Twitter recently. And it's all surrounding this one guy. So he's from Seattle. He's an indie rocker and podcaster named John Roderick. He is in the band The Long Winters. And so...
Ooh, what's your favorite song?
Yeah.
Christmas?
Which album do you like the best?
Thank you. I don't know any of their songs. So anyway, he went on Twitter. This is what he looks like.
He looks like John Goodman.
He's a handsome dude.
Yeah. Kind of like Russell Crowe-ish.
He looks smart.
Very much Russell Crowe.
If Russell Crowe and John Goodman had a baby.
And George Lucas.
Oh, George Lucas.
Oh, yeah. He's got the
look. But he's like the handsome, skinnier George Lucas.
Steven Spielberg. He was about to take off his glasses, too.
Ridiculous.
And the Colonel, but the younger version.
Oh, very much.
Yeah.
So he went to Twitter and he posted a very lengthy story.
Yeah.
A shit ton of tweets.
It must be worth it.
And it has been dubbed Bean Dad?
And he has been dubbed Bean Dad, right?
Because of the story?
Because of the story. Mm-hmm. So what the story is, I'll just read the first tweet and that's it. And then I'll tell you the rest. So it says, "So yesterday, my daughter, 9, was hungry and I was doing a jigsaw puzzle. So I said over my shoulder, 'Make some baked beans.' She said, 'How?' Like all kids do when they want you to do it. So I said, 'Open a can and put it in the pot.' She brought me the can and said, 'Open it how?' So then he goes on this really long telling of the story of how he just made her look at the can opener, look at the can, and force her to figure it out on her own to the point where it took 6 hours for her to figure this out.
What?
And as he's telling the story, like I said, he had already mentioned that she was hungry, right? So a lot of people reading this story, they got triggered from like their own emotional trauma from their parents and how horrible, toxic parenting they've had that in their own childhood. So this went viral and calling him like a horrible dad, very fucking abusive.
What
the
fuck?
How are you gonna have your daughter?
You don't think it's abusive?
Okay.
No, I don't.
Cause
I don't at all, because I'm just like, how old is this kid? 9? 9? Fourth grader? Okay. You don't know how to open a can? I'm like,
thing.
Man, maybe I failed as a parent. You know what? Let's figure this shit out.
That's the attitude.
Let's work on it together.
Him being like, I failed as a parent. She should know how to do this. So let me show her. Then if she asks him tomorrow, it's like, well, we went over this already and you should know. But clearly she doesn't know how to open a can and he's just making her feel stupid and stupid and stupid
for six hours.
If it takes 6 hours, then yeah, there's something else going on here, dude.
But if you've never...
No, I'm with you. I'm with you.
Yeah, exactly. The kid shouldn't be blamed if they weren't taught how to open a can. Yeah. I 100% agree.
He said it took six hours.
So you can't show her the answer. Like, if I didn't...
6 hours is pretty gnarly.
Yeah, that's extreme.
Yeah, and also, he said, no one's eating anything until you get that can of beans open.
But I don't know what the tweets are and what are they? Is he explaining the process? Like, what
excruciatingly explaining it.
I don't know what the tweets are. I also don't know, is the kid like crying this whole time or?
Yeah, I don't know the interaction that went down.
He doesn't explain the interaction. And so what he says is like, he was viewing this from his own perspective and assuming everyone knows his personality, which he claims that his fans know that he does this like bad dad bit on his podcast and that it was supposed to come off as like, as a bit. And so it ended up like, backfiring for him because if you read the whole story,
I read the whole story.
Did it really happen or he's making this up? I'm so confused.
So this story really did happen, but the way that he wrote it, he purposely wrote it in a way where he was like being like a stern, like.
So that's not the real part. The incident is real, but just the details he skewed it.
Even if he told me he did it nicely for 6 hours, I would be like,
well, so
that's pretty gnarly. I didn't catch the 6 hours.
Yeah, there's
he has a lot of patience. I just saw what a patient man. Six fucking hours?
But if it takes,
I give up after 1 minute.
If it takes him 6 hours to teach somebody how to open a can and put and cook some beans, I think he's a very bad teacher.
6 hours, yeah. So, that's ridiculous.
He has a lot of time.
I'm gonna read to you guys petty. His apology, okay?
Well, also, I put myself in the kid's shoes, and so, because I automatically assume that the kid is me, and I'm like, oh, I could totally have dragged that shit out for 12 hours. Like, my dad wanted to teach me something, but I really wanted my dad to do it for me. I would just keep playing dumb and dumb and dumb and dumb and dumb. So I also don't know what kind of kid they're dealing with.
You could see in the story the way he's painting it, like the girl, like she was trying to figure it out, and he's even putting things like, yeah, like she got certain things right, like she's twisting the mechanism, and like he's trying to get her to think like really about the engineering behind a can opener, and but he was like, so she's so close, like she just needs to get the latch onto the can, and like he's like, I'm telling you, he's really going through this whole story like in excruciating detail.
How come you didn't have the one that does it already for you?
I know, right? You put it in the machine.
Because he calls himself in the tweets Apocalypse Dad, so like he wants to have
because you need a can opener in a fucking apocalypse. He's like, I can't open up my can, Dad. There's no can opener. You taught me wrong tools.
Or put the can in the microwave and put it on 50 and watch it explode or something.
Yeah.
Jeez. Does he have a microwave if he's Apocalypse Dad?
He shouldn't.
So I'm gonna read the apology, and it's a little lengthy, so bear with me. It goes, an apology. Hi, I deactivated my Twitter yesterday in a panic. I had to reflect on what I'd done and the hurt I caused, and my mind was clouded by an unprecedented flow of new information. I want to acknowledge and make amends for the injuries I caused. I have many things to atone for. My parenting story's insensitivity and the legacy of hurtful language in my past. Oh, because I forgot to mention, people went to his Twitter account and dug up anti-Semitic stuff.
Oh, like, shit.
Okay. A whole bunch of other bad things that he said in the past. So he says, in my past are both profound failures. I want to confront them directly. My story about my daughter and the can of beans was poorly told. I didn't share how much laughing we were doing, how we had a bowl of pistachios between us all day as we worked on the problem, or that we'd both had a full breakfast together a few hours before. Her mother was in the room with us all day and alternately laughing at us and telling us to be quiet while she worked on her laptop. We all took turns on the jigsaw puzzle. I framed the story with me as the asshole dad because that's my comedic persona, and my fans and friends know it's a bit. What I didn't understand when posting that story was that a lot of the language I used reminded people very viscerally of abuse they'd experienced at the hand of a parent. The idea that I would withhold food from her or force her to solve a puzzle while she cried or bind her to the task for hours without a break, all were images of child abuse that affected many people very deeply. Rereading my story, I can see what I'd done. I was ignorant and sensitive to the message that my pedantic without the ick. Pedant dad,
pendulum.
Comedic persona was indistinguishable from how abusive dads act, talk, and think. I woke up yesterday to find that I had become hashtag bean dad. I was a locus for a tremendous outpouring of anger and grief. It took me hours to fully grasp. I reread the story and saw clearly that I'd framed it so poorly, so insensitively. Bean dad, full of braggadocio and dickhead swagger, was hurting people. I had conjured an abusive parent that many people recognize from real life. I'm deeply sorry for having precipitated more hurt in the world, for having prolonged or exacerbated it by fighting back and being flippant when confronted, and for taking my Twitter feed offline yesterday instead of facing the music. I wish the parents I modeled didn't exist. I wish no one had to grow up with a parent who tortured them physically or emotionally. I would never intentionally make light of those experiences, and I'll never underestimate again the pain I can cause with some poorly chosen words by my acting defensively when challenged. He goes on to talk about the anti-Semitic stuff. And then...
Guys, it was 5 years ago. It was okay to hate Jewish people, right? But obviously, I regret those things.
And then so he ends up saying now, I'm a middle-aged, middle-class, straight white male, and I try to be cognizant of that and of the responsibility my privileges entail in everything I do. In this case, it was precisely my privilege of not living in an abusive family, of not being a member of a community that routinely experiences real trauma, that caused me to so grossly misjudge the impact of the language I chose. I have a lot more reflecting to do in the coming days, so I'll be taking a hiatus from my public life to let some of these lessons sink in. I apologize to my partners, friends, and family for all the people that affected.
It's hard to do comedy on text because if people don't know you and it's on a public platform and they can just read it for face value, and if they don't know the background or whatever, they're just gonna read it and go, well, fucking, this guy's an asshole to his kids.
Yeah, and if you're saying it's a true story, like your kid didn't eat for 6 hours until she could figure out how to open a can, then it's like, that's much different than we all shared pistachios and tried to figure out a can opener together. It's way different.
I'm also ignorant to this stuff, but is it his fault if like, I don't know, Twitter is all, maybe he has a character on Twitter or something and that's the character writing it. Is it his fault that other people are triggered by what he's writing?
It's not his fault, but he's understanding how the negative effects, because he didn't understand the consequence of saying what he wanted to.
Yeah.
So like he was doing his bit, but he didn't realize, like, if he knew that it can hurt people, he wouldn't have done his bit. So, but then there's other people out there that's like, I don't give a fuck. I know that it's gonna hurt some of you, but this is my bit. But then he's taking the approach of saying like, well, if I ever knew that it could hurt these people,
that's not what I'm about.
I'm not gonna do it that style.
Yeah.
Cause I do agree too, like when it comes to doing your own creative work, right?
Yeah.
You have to do it unapologetically, but you can't, you have to also be aware of the results of your actions. Like if you're gonna
and
do
be able to accept
content,
what's gonna happen coming your way.
You can't get mad that people are mad and then you're just like, well, you don't get the joke. And it's like, it's all about execution.
I think that if he was on his podcast, which it sounds like he has like a fan base on his podcast, if he did this bit there, then everyone gets it. Cause they're like, oh, we get when he's being serious and when he's not being serious. But Twitter is such a general, like a broad.
It's writing versus you can't hear the tone.
Yeah,
you don't know what,
And it gets viral so fast cause people share things and then it goes to people who don't know who you are and they don't know the history of your content and all that stuff.
Well, there's also just people, I mean, dude, there's so many fucked up things out there that, like, people can see something on Facebook, say, and go, oh my God, this kid is being abused here. So it's like, it's kind of like that, where people are just seeing this and going, is a child being abused at home? Like, that's fucking crazy. Yeah. And who wouldn't think that way if they read something like that, not knowing all this other shit?
But also, you also can't control the projections of people. Because when I heard this, I'm like, damn, he spent 6 hours giving her that attention to teach her something? I didn't hear abuse. You heard abuse.
Yeah.
Because my baseline is real abuse.
Yeah.
Is my dad would get frustrated in 30 minutes and beat my ass.
But don't call it real abuse. Right. You got physical abuse. Well, this is emotional trauma.
It's different abuse.
It's
you're
psychological
right.
Psychological abuse, yeah.
Right. So I got the emotional, psychological, and the physical on top of the.
So just because the physical is missing doesn't mean it's not abuse.
I would, okay, not real then. It's more intense. Because there was extra consequences that stacked upon just emotional, right? So then the severity of it was like, my baseline is much, much lower to where other people can see this and be triggered and say, this is exactly what I went through. Where I see the grass is greener effect and I see this and I go, oh, that's fucking awesome.
Well, you're seeing
yours is more, it's not as nuanced.
They're giving, the dad's giving her attention this whole time, but then people that have actually gone through this type of trauma, like they're not getting attention from their parent. They're just being.
I'm not rewriting the fact that, I'm not discrediting the fact that it's abuse for people. All I'm saying is,
your perspective
we have
is
a different,
different
perspective because if you've gone through a situation where you feel that your parent's threatening your life, that is a different form of abuse where you hear things like this and you go, oh, cool, he gave them attention. Mm-hmm. Not realizing that that's also harmful. And also, you see it as that's better.
And also, I think the point that he's making is also when there's text, everyone's projecting something else, right? For me, I automatically projected myself because as a 9-year-old, I was a fucking shithead. So if my parents are trying to get me to do something I don't want, I'm like, you want to go to war? We'll drag this out for 3 days straight if you want. So I automatically go, oh shit, this is a little genius at work. It's a little like Harley Quinn at work that's dragging something that can take 30 minutes. She's dragging it to 6 hours.
So you were like, poor dad.
Yes.
I'm like, so I'm how lucky dad. She got attention. He's like, how abusive.
So I was just like, man, this is crazy that like someone's writing like everyone can view it from completely different angles.
I didn't even get the 6-hour part, so I was like, tight. It's fucking, he's teaching this kid how to fish.
Yeah.
Like how to like take care of himself.
So important.
Yeah, it's crazy.
But then the problem I think is when you have a consensus of people who believe that it's one way and only one way, like they already made up their minds that this man is a horrible, abusive human being. Mm-hmm. And I think when you pass judgment like that without even knowing the whole story, that's what's fucked up.
Yep, 100%.
Yeah. But it's easy to do because it's like on social media.
Especially if everybody is
confirming your thoughts.
Yeah.
Adding it's like more an echo. To that with the past tweets, be like, see, here's more evidence of him being a shitty person.
It escalates quickly.
Yeah. That's why I think it's just dangerous right now to play with anything controversial or dark humor or anything like that.
Yeah.
Because it's just, oh man, it's just fucked up.